Christ died for the ungodly. That means he died for everybody, because everybody was sinful. Everybody was ungodly. And because everyone was ungodly, and he has died for the ungodly, he died for you, for scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet, peradventure for a good man, some would even dare venture to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It's not waiting until you turn over a new leaf before the death can be effective, efficacious in your life. It's not waiting until you can make yourself better. He is the one to make you better. He is the one to forgive you. He is the one to set you free. He is the one to cleanse you. He is the one to purge you. You can come just as you are, but he will not send you away just as you are. He will forgive. He will set free. He will transform your life. He will change your life. He'll make you a new creature in Christ. Transformation comes with that forgiveness. Renewal comes with that forgiveness. Regeneration, that he makes you a new afresh, that comes with that forgiveness. Then it says in verse 9, much more then, being justified by his blood. Underline that in your Bible, by his blood he justifies. By his blood he saves. By his blood he transforms your life. Being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. That's a great benefit. Eternal wrath is taken away. Eternal sojourn in hell is taken away. Eternal punishment is taken away. The wrath of God is removed because of that atonement of Jesus Christ. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. That's talking about our redemption. That's talking about the forgiveness, the pardon, the peace, the relationship, reconciliation that we now have with the Almighty God because of the sacrifice of Jesus, because of the shedding of the blood of Jesus for us. Ephesians chapter 1. In Ephesians chapter 1, reading from verse 7. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood. Think of redemption. In whom we have redemption through his blood. Forgiveness is in that redemption. Peace of God is in that redemption. Freedom is in that redemption. Actually, the word redemption comes from the fact of people being sold into slavery. And anybody that comes to redeem them, to take them, to rescue them from that slavery is called the Redeemer. And what they have got through that is the redemption. And it says, you know, we have redemption. We have the freedom. It sets us free from the power of sin, from the hold of sin. It sets us free from the hold of Satan. It sets us free from the imprisonment and from the enslavement of sin. That's what it says there. It gives us redemption, forgiveness, freedom, liberty. Now we can have dominion because we're no more slaves of sin. That's what the blood of Jesus Christ does. If you have not got that, I believe that today as you come to the Lord and you turn away from evil and say, Lord, this is what I want, total redemption, so that I will not continue being a slave to sin, a slave to bad habits, a slave to evil, a slave to all the lives I've lived in the past. He will do it for you. In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians chapter 2, reading here from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 11. It grants us pardon. It grants us forgiveness. It grants us peace. It grants us reconciliation with God. It grants us total serenity, peace of mind. Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 11. Wherefore, remember that you being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time, before redemption, at that time, before the pardon, at that time, before justification, at that time, before you were cleansed with the blood of Jesus Christ, at that time, before you applied the full efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ in your soul, in your spirit, in your life. But because at that time, ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. See the state of the sinner, the state of the one that is not redeemed yet, the state of the one that has not applied the blood of Jesus Christ by faith. You see the state in which they are. It says they're without Christ, without the covenant of promise, and without the privilege of Calvary. And then it says without God in this world. It says, but now, when you come to Christ, but now, when you repent, but now, when you turn away from your sin, but now, when you realize the blood of Jesus can make you clean, it says, but now, when you realize there's salvation in Christ, it says, but now, when you realize you don't have to perish, you don't have to be without God, without Christ, without salvation, it says, but now, in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. That's reconciliation. Made nigh by the blood of Christ, reconciled by the blood of Christ, forgiven by the blood of Christ, brought into the presence of God by the blood of Christ, brought into relationship with God by the blood of Christ. That's the only thing that can bring you into relationship with God. Because a sinner cannot maintain relationship with God. God is holy, God is righteous, God is pure. And you are separated from God. Your sin separates you from God. But the blood of Jesus Christ that provides forgiveness, the blood of Jesus Christ that grants that reconciliation, is the one thing that brings you peace with the Lord. It goes on in verse 14, for he is our peace. That's Jesus. He is our peace. The one who shed his blood for you, he is our peace. The one that grants you pardon, that grants you forgiveness, the one that brings you reconciliation with God, he is our peace. The one who takes your place and he bore your sin. And you can have his righteousness. The one who gave his life as a substitute for you, for he is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of partition between us. The wall of partition between the Jews and the Gentiles broken down. The wall of partition between the sinner and God broken down. Reconciliation has now taken place. And newness of life has now come. A new relationship has now come. And it is through the blood of Jesus Christ. There are many people that do not realize that this reconciliation with God and this partnership with God, this relationship with God is so very important, because that's what brings you very close to the Lord himself, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. Again, it reminds you that you have peace with God, and you have peace in your heart, and you have peace with the brethren, and that he might reconcile both to God, the Jew, the Gentile, both to God. And it's through the blood of Jesus Christ that this is done. There's no reconciliation through any other means. Religion does not bring reconciliation. And whatever you do by yourself does not bring conciliation. But it is what Christ has done. The shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ, that he might bring reconciliation, he might reconcile both unto God in one body by his cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And in verse 16, and that he might reconcile both to God in one body by his cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And he came and he preached peace to you, proclaimed peace to you, and declared peace to you, and he's brought the peace unto you which were afar off, and to them which were nigh, afar off, the Gentiles, and those who are near, the Jews. And then, for through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore, saved, now therefore, justified, now therefore, having peace with God, now therefore, reconciled unto God, now therefore, ye are no more strangers. Are you washed in the blood of Jesus? Then you are no more strangers and foreigners. Have you been reconciled unto God by the shedding of the blood of Christ? Now ye are no more strangers and foreigners. Have you got that peace of God and that pardon? Does the Spirit bear witness with your heart that you are now a child of God, and the presence of Christ within keeps you victorious over the sins of the past? He says, now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, the means of our reconciliation with God, the means of our relationship with God. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, for as much as you know, if you have experienced this salvation, if you have experienced this peace, if you have got this pardon, if your heart is now free, if the burden of sin has been taken away, if the guilt of sin has been canceled, if there's a freedom within, and if there is now victory over the sins of the past, now you know, for as much as you know, that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but for the precious blood of Christ. That's the means of our salvation, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the pardon, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the peace, the precious blood of Christ. That's what gives us the freedom, bought with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. That's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 26, verse 28. Matthew chapter 26, verse 28. For this is my blood of the New Testament, of the New Covenant. The old covenant being celebrated by the Passover feast was passing away. And then Jesus turned to his own disciples. He said, the Passover of the Jews will now stop here, will end here. And he says, because a new dawn, a new dispensation, a new covenant is being put in place right now. And this is now the blood, my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. This is what takes the guilt of sin away. It takes the power of sin away. It takes the presence of sin away. It takes the punishment for sin, takes it away. This is the blood of Jesus, grants us peace with God, grants us pardon from God, goes beyond that, grants us purity and power. We come to point number two now, purity and power through his blood. The same blood that grants us salvation also grants us sanctification. The same blood that grants us forgiveness also grants us freedom. The same blood that grants us peace and pardon also grants us purity and power over sin. We come to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, and I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12. In the old age, that's the blood the Jewish people have relied on from the time of Moses until the time of Christ. That's the blood that stops in its efficacy at the point of the cross of Jesus Christ. That's why it says it's no more by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood. It's referring to Christ. By his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He went to heaven and he showed the Almighty God the Father, the judge of all the earth. He said, look at my blood shed for the people. I obtained redemption, and not just temporary redemption, eternal redemption for all that will believe and keep on believing on me. In verse 13, for if the blood of bulls and goats in the old covenant and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies thee to the purifying of the flesh in the old covenant. Now in the new covenant, verse 14, how much more? You think about the people of the old covenant. People like Enoch that had victory over sin. Old covenant. You think of a person like Samuel that had victory over sin. And just as old covenant. You think about Abraham that became the friend of God. That's the old covenant. You think about Moses. About Joshua. About the people of the old covenant that the Lord approved of their lives. You think about Elisha, old covenant. And it says, all those people, they got the victory through the blood of goats and bulls. Because at that time, in their old time, that was the sacrifice God appointed for them, waiting for the time of Christ. It says, if they had such victory at that time, if they had such purity at that time, if Daniel in Babylon had such righteousness, godliness, purity, holiness at that time, only by the sacrifice of the blood of bulls and of goats, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience, purge your heart. That means purify your heart.